thank you. Do you have the clicker? Oh, here we go. Yes, my name is Kalev. It does rhyme with olive. The half of you who heard me speak say that's my standard way of introducing myself. I go by a few other things, too. I'm often called the bow tie guy. I will respond to that. I was recently late to a teleconference, and as I beeped in, overheard someone say, Kalev, yeah, he's the guy who sounds kind of like an elf. which is probably also on brand. I've been called worse, I mean, really. So I'm gonna actually just play around with the main theme of the conference today. We're actually gonna talk about what it means to orchestrate and orchestration. And I actually thought, let's just start by listening to some music, not that cell phone, some music. I think my general rule is that if your cell phone goes off, I'm gonna take your phone and read your last three texts to the whole room. No, just kidding, understand. But a good reminder, if you could put them on silent, that'd be great, because this is gonna be, the whole day is gonna be an audiovisual experience. So I'm gonna play a song, and I want you guys just to listen to it for a little bit, and then we'll talk a little bit about it. Does anybody speak Italian? A little bit? Okay. Does anybody recognize this song? Okay, great. That's actually beneficial. So we had a tenor sing for a little bit, now we have a soprano coming in. Slow, lyrical, swooping up and down melody. Male voice is getting a little bit insistent. The female voice is hesitating. Now they're responding to each other a little bit more quickly. She drags off a little bit, becomes a little silent. He insists. Okay, I'm gonna pause there. And does anybody want to take a stab at the question that's on the slide? What kind of song is that? Anybody?
Opera.
Opera, that's good. Excellent. What do you think the song is about? Love, yes. So nobody in the room, or almost nobody, spoke Italian. You didn't recognize the piece. Why do you say that it's love?
Because they sound like they're having a conversation.
Right, they seem to be having a conversation. Anything else about it that makes you think it's about love? It's a man, it's a woman, it's sweeping. Do you guys agree, generally, head nodding, that you think it's a love song? Okay, good. You're right. The piece is a famous aria from Mozart's Don Giovanni. It's called La ci darem la mano, it means give me your hand. Right there, these are the somewhat cheesy lyrics. And basically what's happening in Don Giovanni, who is like the original ladies' man, is that he's trying to seduce this peasant girl named Zerlina. And so he's trying to get her to, you know, to come off to him to celebrate their innocent love off stage, which is pretty funny. In fact, if you keep playing the song, this is where they start singing in unison. Like, what was that? Did you guys hear that? Right at the climax, I'm gonna play it again. Celebrate an innocent love. That is the sound of sarcasm in the 18th century. Because Mozart and the audience know there's nothing innocent about what they're gonna do off stage. Let's try the same exercise, but let's do it with a different song, okay? Same question, but I want you guys to listen to this a little bit and ask yourself, what kind of song is this? All right, that of course is Cheerleader by OMI, which is huge, right? You probably all heard that song at some point, right? What kind of song is this song?
Pop.
Pop. What is it about? It's a love song. If it were not in a language you understand, like if you didn't understand the words, would you know that it was a love song? No. No, right? So let's do a super relevant comparison between Mozart and OMI. right? I mean, Cheerleader is a monster of a song. It's catchy, it's super danceable. It has a very common pop structure. Verse, hook, bridge, hook, right? Almost all pop songs will follow the same structure. And the meaning is pretty much in the lyrics. The rest is for fun. Like, you could have composed that whole song and swipe it up with lyrics, and I'm gonna say it would be just as danceable and awesome, right? Now, La Ci Do Re Mi Mano is pretty different. Pretty full instrumentation, modulated dynamics, that means they go up and down and get softer, quieter. The structure of the music is tied to the lyrical structure, meaning the words, right? You have this offer by a man and then a woman, and it gets closer together, and it ends in unison. And because of the way that piece is composed and orchestrated, you can figure out the entire meaning without even knowing any of the words, which in the meaning is in the entire performance of that piece of music, not just in the words, right? So what does this have to do with digital marketing? That's a pretty fair question. So taking a little bit of a step back, I have been talking to people about digital strategy for a long time. Like John, when I was in college, the web did not exist. So I've been able to watch the evolution of what digital strategy consists of. And for a long time, you could finish a digital strategy proposition by saying, you know, we need to start using, you know, and initially in the 90s, it was the web, right? Like, we really need to start using the web, and then maybe it was video. We really need to start using email, CRM, blogs. You know, iPhone got released, and then all of a sudden, everybody had to be mobile, right? Social media, SEO, sort of. Kind of like going to the dentist. No one likes doing it, but if you don't, you know you're gonna be in a lot of trouble. So we do it. Then in 2011, responsive design. Lately, there've been a lot of tactics like programmatic advertising and native advertising. I mean, pretty much, this is what digital strategy has meant. It means like there's another great tactic or technique that you have to start learning about and using and integrating into your digital marketing. Now I think we're at a really interesting inflection point. Because you know, my take on it is that B2B marketers, especially, do not need any more tactics. So this is research that comes from the Content Marketing Institute. Some of you are probably familiar with this survey. They do it every couple of years. The average B2B marketer uses an average 13 tactics, which means there are a lot of people who use even more, right? And 12 of those are inherently digital. There's one tactic on the slide that is not necessarily digital, and that's in-person events. Everything else is pretty much digital. The good news is that confidence in those tactics is rising, so we're actually, as marketers, generally more confident that we're actually getting return on investment. So in the last 2 years, this actually comes from an Accenture survey. CMOs believe that digital is paying off more than it has in the past. This budget item I pulled out because I thought it was really interesting. 37% of the CMOs, and these are B2B CMOs, interviewed by Accenture, said that 75% of their budget will be digital in the next couple years. Keep in mind that a lot of B2B firms, that budget still includes things like client entertainment, right? And that's a pretty unmovable number if you're a CMO and you have that number on your balance sheet, right? You're gonna have to take clients out to dinner. Which means the vast majority of the stuff that everybody is doing is digital. What's interesting about that, so we're more confident about each individual tactic and each individual digital thing that we're doing, but we're actually less confident about our ability to do it well and in an integrated and well-orchestrated way. So the confidence in, does all my digital fit together? In other words, are we actually using digital strategically, has fallen 7 points from 2012 to 2014. So we're more digital than ever, we're spending more than ever, we believe that each individual tactic is giving us better ORI, but we think we're worse when it comes to the overall picture, right? And there's some nodding. Do you guys generally agree? Like, does this feel right? I have to say, when I talk to a lot of CMOs in our work, my work, I very often hear, like, I don't need any more digital. I have digital. I have web. I have blogs. I have email. I've got a CRM. I've got a marketing automation tool. I have all this. What I don't know is how is it all supposed to work together? So that's really where the idea of orchestration comes in. And we're not the only ones to start using this term. There was a report by Forrester Research that really said the top problem in digital marketing is how do I orchestrate and integrate everything together, right? The new goal is learning to orchestrate across all the different activities that you have as a marketer or a communicator. So, you know, marketing orchestration, what is it? It is all about optimizing a set of related cross-channel interactions that when added together make up to a more personalized customer experience. Sounds pretty straightforward. How do we do that is a fair question for someone like me, right? So if I were a more typical consultant, I'd probably pick a framework like the three Ps and try to bring you through a set of best practices. There are a lot of different models, however, for frameworks. There's the three Ps, there's the four Ps. If you keep Googling, you'll find the seven Ps. Then you'll find other people saying, no, wait, it's the three Ps, right? Really, my attitude to all such approaches are that best practices are great when you need to catch up. Best practices, however, lead to competence. They don't lead to innovation, right? They make us as good as a recognized standard. They won't make you better than anybody else. So I'm actually going to come at it from a different way, and this is a little bit more of an honestly design-oriented way. What makes it different from a typical sort of consulting approach is that whereas analysts start by breaking down the problem and researching it and follow a model and a methodology, and then at the end out pops an answer and says, this is your plan, design-oriented thinkers tend to say, let's imagine what the correct end solution is, and then we'll back into the analysis about what it takes to get there. But let's begin with looking at what we actually want to be. So today I'm going to take a step through orchestration through these five aspects: score, instrumentation, dynamics, cadence, and audience, just so that we can start taking a look at what does really good marketing orchestration look like. So we're going to start with score. And in extending this metaphor even further, my take on it is that the score is your brand. Right, so the score is literally what music is going to be played for marketers. That really corresponds to your brand, the core of what you do. That's kind of what you are playing. It's both the guide and the unifying force that pulls every single action into a coherent experience. And what's kind of interesting when you think about scoring, musical scoring, is that it hasn't changed a lot in terms of how we actually write down and record music and give conductors and players you know, the music they're supposed to be playing. It looks pretty similar. So we have over here early 15th, late 14th century manuscript. I think that's actually by Hildegard from Bingen. We have here early music from some of the earliest printed music from Don Quixote. And over here, 2010, anybody read music enough to recognize who this is? It's, of course, Katy Perry. Three totally different kinds of music, right? You're gonna hear a completely different experience, but the basic way that we notate music is pretty similar. It hasn't changed in almost 600 years. So in a similar way, the way that we define the core of a brand hasn't changed a lot with digital. This is a brand model that our head of brand, Ryan Scholes, uses. You're gonna be hearing from him next. And the part that digital has really changed isn't even really like how do we start off with the core and how do we think about brand, nor is it actually the outcome, which is the overall client or customer experience, but it has changed almost entirely the logistics of how you execute and activate that brand. So there are two aspects of brand activation that we'll talk about briefly that come up when you think about the transformation into digital. The first has to do with how you visually express that brand, and the second has to do with what happens with content. So the first one, and if you've listened to One North for a while, you know that we've been talking about this for a while, so I won't belabor it. But the idea of thinking of your visual expression in a natively digital way, which means thinking about things that you didn't in print, it's not just the color, the font, and the logo mark. You have to think about motion and animation and transition and all these aspects of visual brand that play into it. So this is, you're seeing a short clip from the website of a manufacturing firm, a B2B manufacturing firm. Right? They make sensors and devices, but they've given a lot of thought into how does that brand, you know, which they have colors, fonts, a logo mark, how does it actually play out in a digital space, right? The second aspect that I want you to think about, or sorry, you, on these visual brands that we've pointed these out a lot, when you're thinking about how to package it up, many people, if they have a brand guide, it's a PDF or a booklet. How many people have a brand guide that's a PDF or a booklet? Like everybody, right? Yeah. So what we're starting to see is that a lot of forward-leaning brands are actually defining that brand in itself in a digital space. So if you want to look at what that, want to take a look at what that looks like and what it could be for you, there are two great examples. First one from the BBC. They call it the global experience language, and if you go on there, you will find them talking about motion and animation and transformations as part of their brand language, on top of ideas about essence, purpose, messaging, color, that sort of thing. Another great example is Google's material design. I think this is one of the most awesome, sneakiest moves Google has ever done. They offered up essentially their brand guidelines as a design methodology, and now they have everyone making all of their apps and websites look like Google, which is fantastic and admirable in an evil sort of a way. The second aspect has to do with something that I call brand fade. And I'm going to use an example we've used in the past because I think it illustrates it pretty well. So success for digital content means what? That it gets shared, that it gets extended, that it actually falls further and further away from contexts in which we control. So if you see this PwC survey, they launched a piece of content onto their web, it goes out onto the YouTube, it gets shared into LinkedIn, it gets picked up by Forbes, then it gets picked up by an industry blog, right? And so the funny thing about the way digital works is the more successful your content is, the less control you have over its visual presentation. Right? So if you think about brand as how you present things and how things look and feel, and you don't think about content, you get this sort of progressive brand fade, which means that you really need those brand associations to be inside the content itself. Here's a really great example of, I think, that in action. BCG, the Boston Consulting Group, has a partnership with TED. This is a page that they put up where they've gotten a number of their partners to sort of speak at TED events and give presentations. What's amazing is that there is none of the BCG framework around any of this, right? There's no branding from a visual perspective from BCG, but the brand associations are inside the content itself, right? And that is what it takes in order to maintain brand in a digital context. So no matter how much times this content gets copied or shared or makes its way through the web, those brand associations are firm, and they have to deal with not just how it looks, but themes and topics. What are you talking about? Is the topic on brand? Is the format on brand? Is the narrative approach? Are you even talking to the right audience, right? Are you talking to them? For BCG, it's, you know, we're not talking to middle managers, we're talking to the C-suite. We don't deal with everyday problems, we deal with big problems. We lean into the future, we don't talk about the past. That sort of things. And it's that kind of brand guidelines, those kinds of aspects of their brand that can make it into the heart of the content. So let's get back to a little bit of music, because brand, as important as it is, and I hope I've convinced you that it's actually really critical, it's only the start. So I'm going to play two songs. First one.
Well, sometimes I go out.
Thank you.
Across the water.
Does anybody know who this is? Amy Winehouse, so
and
awesome.
I think of all the
singing Valerie.
And in my head.
Now what's interesting, this next song, also Amy Winehouse, same performer, same music, same song, same lyrics, different producer, different orchestrator, right? So this next song is also Valerie by Amy Winehouse, but Mark Ronson produced it.
Hi, it's Roland.
Johnny Murphy, I was having too much fun.
Well, sometimes I go out by myself.
Much more fun version, right?
Across the water.
The point is that you could define the brand very thoroughly, and still there's a lot in the actual performance that's going to determine how it actually feels and what it's actually going to do. So as we go on, let's talk about the next theme. Let's talk about instrumentation. In a digital world, your tactics are your instruments, right? And if you think about it, the same note, you can play a middle C on just about every instrument in the entire orchestra. There's even a timpani, a drum that plays a C, essentially, right? But they all have a different timbre. They all have a different tone, and they're going, that one same note, that same frequency, is going to sound a lot very different depending on which instrument you're actually playing. So we actually already looked at all the stuff that said, you know, there's lots and lots of new tactics. The one thing that I want you to think about is that not every new tactic is a good tactic. So one of the things that's interesting in classical music, right at about 1800, and this is where I feel like my very expensive education is finally paying itself off, is that right at about that time, the orchestra starts to explode. So if you know anything about music history, earlier, what we think of as an orchestra was really dominated by strings and a few woodwinds. So it was violins, violas, cellos, and some oboes and some clarinets. And then right at about 1800, it started being added to with new instruments like the piano, percussion, the entire brass section, trumpets, trombones, tubas, all of that. And so all of a sudden the orchestra is much larger and every composer and conductor has literally, you know, twice the number of instruments that they can use. And some people, like Wagner, use pretty much them all. He's pretty much famous for using all of them. You guys know this as the Bugs Bunny song? Or the Elmer Fudd song, right? Totally. This is how most of us learn about classical music. And to create that song, this is the Ride of the Valkyries, Die Walküre from Wagner. To create that sound, he uses pretty much the entire orchestra just coming at the audience. Every instrument is playing at the same time. But what's also interesting is that some composers at the exact same time are famous for doing the complete opposite. So this next one is Schubert, and they really, you know, at the same time, some of this music is very quiet, and he, you know, is famous for composing these songs that just use a few instruments at a time. It starts with a piano and a single voice, right? He has every instrument at his disposal. He doesn't play every single instrument at the same time. It's usually one note at a time. Does anybody recognize this piece? It's a little bit harder. I chose that it's by Schubert. I chose that piece because the title is The Elf King. So we're just making it all come back to me. You weren't supposed to find it that funny. And like you said, we've already talked about this digital marketing explosion. How many people have seen this poster or have it like hanging up somewhere in their office? These are ridiculous. They're only designed to scare people. These posters are so pointless. They either scare marketers into thinking that you have no idea what you're doing, or if you're really smart, you show it to a stakeholder and you say, I need more money because there's so much more that I need to do, right? And some people have recently tried to make a lot more sense out of it. So Gartner Group, which is a great research arm, did anybody see this when it came out? This made the rounds, right? They kind of did it like the tube map in London or transportation. And they really tried to add a lot more clarity and structure rather than just having like a list of stuff. But I have to say, if you can read this and understand what it means, yeah, you are a lot smarter than I am, because I look at the thing and I'm still just lost. I have no idea what I'm looking at. Roadmaps only work when you know where you're going. So the nice thing about like all these different tactics that are coming up, like all these different social channels, is that we do understand that there are some stable patterns, right? Like we have enough experience with that explosion of social media to know that our annual reports probably belong on LinkedIn and maybe not so much on Instagram. Right? We kind of have a sense of what's working. And you know, when we evaluate new tactics, the tricky thing is that I have to say they're gonna keep coming at you. There's still going to be a lot of new tactics coming at you. So what I encourage people to do is to strategically evaluate new tactics. You can't ignore them, but you don't have to accept every single one that comes down the pipe at you. And you really have to think about what does it mean in terms of brand alignment and authenticity, not just effectiveness. It's not just how many eyeballs can I get my piece of content in front of, right? And native advertising actually points that out. Are you guys familiar with native advertising? It's basically paid content placement, right? These are arrangements that you might have with a content publisher. And sometimes it works really well, like you have EY, formerly Ernst & Young, a piece of sponsored content on Forbes. Two brands perfectly aligned, talking about the same things. This is native advertising at its best, right? This is really good paid content marketing. Sometimes, however, it doesn't work so well. So this is a paid content post that made it into The Atlantic. You guys are familiar with The Atlantic, right? Monthly magazine, kind of highbrow. The Scientologist, the Church of Scientology, paid to place this glowingly awesome article about how fantastic David Miscavige is, right, their leader. It's a milestone year. And this was, unfortunately for them, very quickly picked up by The Onion, who responded with this article. Right? So it can be effective, or it can actually be pretty destructive to your brand, right? You have to be very careful about new tactics and make sure that they're not just going to work in terms of the numbers, but that it's actually going to be the appropriate context for whatever you need to do. Let's talk about dynamics. So dynamics really has to do with how hard or soft. When you think about this, if the song is just continuously loud, not only can it be uncomfortable, but it's just kind of tedious if it's just constantly loud and kind of screaming at you. And the same things if it's entirely too soft. So if you ever sat through like a Philip Glass piece, he's a modern composer, and he has a piece where like somebody's just dinging one note on a piano for 20 minutes, you just want to tear your ears off your head. It's just so obnoxious. It's just, there's no variation. And so what I usually encourage people to think about is what that variation means. So you guys will probably know this piece from the 4th of July, right? Most people are really familiar with this part of it. These are actual cannons. This is used by the Chicago Symphony Orchestra in the recording of this piece, right? Boom. So what's your cannonball? When I think about it in terms of marketing, digital marketing especially, the cannonball is the big report and the big campaign. And they all have a place. So things like this PDF from PwC. This is from a law firm, Freshfields, Brooke Druckhauser, right? Here's this nice article. There are something like 27 subsections. Right? It obviously took them a lot. It's a huge and fantastic report. It's all about the potential impacts of Britain leaving the EU, right? So they did a huge amount of analysis of like, what if Britain leaves the EU, what does this mean, right? So it's a great piece. And this is McKinsey Quarterly, their iPad app, right? Big, huge, thoughtful reports, in-depth, meaningful, data-informed. They're great pieces. There's nothing wrong with having them, and they can even be really inherently digital. So you can see these great pieces from Bloomberg. This is from the Boston Consulting Group again about a piece called Strategy Traps. But they require a lot of work, right? Work to produce, work to promote, work on behalf of the audience to read, right, these big pieces. And they can't possibly be relevant to all people at the same time. So if you spend too much time thinking about the cannonballs, the big reports, you're going to end up, by definition, missing some people, right? So we often talk about what does it take to arrange loud and soft pieces together. So the first example is from some people who might actually be in the room, Seyfarth Lean Consulting. It's a consulting arm of a law firm. They're not very big, right? But the way that they arrange their content is about ideas and topics. And so underneath the topic, there are some big pieces. There are some white papers and some research reports, but there are also blog posts and smaller pieces and some videos, because what they know what's relevant to the user is really the topic. It's not that it is a report. You know, people don't go back and say, I need a research report. They say, I need something about subject X, right? And they arrange it that way. And Adobe with the CMO.com does the same thing. If you go here, this entire website is just arranged by topic, and within each topic is an immense variation. The cannonballs are still good. They can be what you need when you really need to get somebody's attention, like Tchaikovsky at the end of the 1812 orchestra. But Tchaikovsky did not use cannonballs for the whole thing. He used them in the last 60 seconds, and that's it. So let's talk about cadence. Cadence is really about timing. Cadence in music is really interesting. It can define the purpose of a song. It's the beat that makes something a dance song. it's, you know, it, if a dance song is a dance song because the beat is usually between 60 and 90 beats per minute, which is not coincidentally the same rate as your elevated heart rate, right? But it's also what allows multiple formers to play together, right? If everybody needs to know the beat and play to the same beat in order to play together. So here's another little bit of test. I just want to know if you guys know this beat. Yes. I played you one beat and you knew what song it is. What song is it?
Sexy
Back. Yes. Justin Timberlake. This is the point at which I'd like to confess that all this music was already on my iPhone. So it's not just Bach, but I do have everything. You know what's really fascinating about beats or bass lines in pop music is that they actually earn a lot of money. They are so important, right? I played you one beat and you knew what that song is. They're so important to the financial success of a particular song that people earn a ton of money for just the bass line, meaning no melody, no lyrics. Just the beat can earn somebody anywhere from $50,000 to $250,000. So, and we know this because people like Timbaland bragged that he earned $250,000 just for the beat of an Alia song, right? And then the song had to be written, right? So this is what I like to think of Justin Timberlake after paying Jay-Z for Sexy Back. It's expensive. Now, we all know what a beat should look like. I mean, you probably know where I was going with this metaphor. It's an editorial calendar. Here's the thing, and I sort of feel like the schoolmaster that keeps yelling at people for doing their homework. We all know that we should have one. Very few of us ever do one. It's just not documented, even though we keep seeing that people who are really effective, that it's actually a differentiator, that people who are really effective tend to have a documented content strategy, whereas, surprise, surprise, people who think that they're not that good a content strategy tend not to have documented any part of it. Calendars are actually not that difficult. You can Google and find any number of examples. It's usually a simple matrix that says, what will I be talking about, kind of, sort of, when, right? I like to encourage people that you don't have to have specific dates. You can simply leave things at, like, maybe weekly this, maybe monthly that, that sort of thing. But any part of that, they can even be non-digital. Right? This is just post-it notes up on a wall, keeps things flexible, I can move things around. But it should talk about things like, where am I going to put it, what topics am I going to talk about, and when should it go out. When we think of timing, there's two different aspects that I think become important. You guys have probably seen, there's lots of infographics about this, like what time of day is the right time. It has a huge impact on how effective that piece of content is. There's a big difference between posting something at 8 a.m. and 10 a.m. Right? The spoiler is that, you know, mid-afternoon and mid-morning are the two best times to post content, business content. My one warning, though, is that especially if you operate globally across multiple time zones, that means it's shifting and occurring at different times. And we've actually heard this from some people that we've done user research with. I've talked to people, for example, who are based in Europe or Asia, and their complaints about receiving your reports and your marketing emails at night are pretty strong. They hate it. It's not just that it isn't effective, it's, you know, these people very often have to keep their iPhones and their BlackBerries turned on, and when they get interrupted to get a newsletter at 10 p.m., they get annoyed. And so I often tell people you need to be careful and try segmenting your email marketing list by time zone, which is not often a segmentation that we think about a lot. There's another aspect, and I'm going to go back to the PwC and just mention this quickly, because we've talked about this before, or at least I have, that, you know, when you really think about cadence, it's not just specific timing or time of day. It's also about everything you do before and after certain kinds of events, right? So with that survey that we saw when I was talking about brand fade, what they do, what's really nice, is before the survey even comes out, they start generating a little bit of buzz by having their CEO tweet individual statistics from the report. So the report hasn't been released, but they'll say, here's one stat, the rest is coming in 4 days, right? Which helps build a lot of expectations. Then it comes out, and they publish it on the web, and they release it at an event. And then after that launch, you know, a big aspect is that they keep the conversation going, or they keep getting a lot more return on the same content piece by posting things out progressively to YouTube, having their partners post out to LinkedIn in the several weeks and months thereafter. And that's all aspects of having a good sense of timing for your content. So one of the last things, it really has to do with the notion of audiences. And you'll probably notice that people at One North tend to, we tend to equate them, but what we're really doing, in other words, we switch between audience and user a lot. Well, there's a reason why digital people tend to veer towards user, and that's because in a digital world, your audience is not just sitting there listening to stuff, right? In a digital context, your audience is now active, which is why designers like us tend to use the word user rather than audience. And you've probably heard this before. Digital is inherently participatory, right? It's not like you're just sitting there watching stuff. So audiences within a digital context, they love to sing along if you let them, right? Have any of you guys heard about the do-it-yourself messiah? It actually occurs a block away from here. Yeah? It's been going on. It's going to have its 40th anniversary this year. It's pretty super cool. And before we play any part of it, what it is there's an orchestra on the stage that plays the instrumentation, and then the audience is the chorus. So if you go, you get assigned your part, right? Tenor, bass, soprano, alto, mezzo soprano, and you sit in your section, and they give you the sheet music, and you actually, everybody sings along. The audience is the chorus. And it doesn't sound too bad. I mean, that's especially not bad for an iPhone recording, right? My mom took to me that when I was 9. I was horribly lost and had no idea what was going on, but it was a blast. It's a lot of fun. It changes your relationship to the music entirely when you're desperately trying to keep up and have no idea what you're doing, but it's really good fun. So what does this look like in a digital context? Well, when I bring up user participation, I have to say most marketers get really, really nervous. And in part, that's because the early experiences really had to deal with comments. And as we all know, comments bring out trolls. There's a reason we call it the bottom half of the internet, right? And in fact, a lot of people have simply shut them down. If you're interested, actually, this article in The New Yorker was really great just about the psychology of commenting and why does it go south so quickly? Like, why is it not useful? And why have so many major news audiences simply turn them off, right? The way that I like to put it, the short version, and this actually affects a lot of design, because when you ask for a comment, you aren't actually asking for user participation. You're asking for a critique. And this really affects design. And very often, you know, designers, like the ones at One North, if they hear saying, okay, we're going to have to go show this to somebody or get their approval, we will respond with, well, can we involve them up front? Because when you have a finished work product and you bring it to a major stakeholder and you say, is this okay, it's almost like they don't feel like they're doing their job unless they find something wrong with it or ask you to change something, right? That's the psychology of that kind of moment when you're asking somebody to comment or review. For them to feel like they're doing a good job and engaging, they have to ask you to change it, which was ironically not what you really wanted when you sent it to them for a comment, right? So the user real participation is the key. And we've started to see some techniques that change the mode of user participation on the web. And that, you know, it really goes back to thinking about what was different about the do-it-yourself messiah. The reason why the do-it-yourself messiah is so awesome and fun is because it is not open mic, right? Like, people do not all come and sing a different song or their own song and expect everybody to enjoy it. You are all singing the same song, and you're given a role and a structure and a place to sit, and you have to go along with other people in order for it to all work. Right? So some simple things. This is medium.com. How many people actually like go on medium.com? Yeah, it's becoming really popular. We're actually seeing some of our clients use it as a blogging platform. It's a really great reading experience, but part of that is also like highlighting tools and commenting tools. You can do things like comment, but comment just directly to the author. And in fact, that can be controlled by the publicist. So you can engage a conversation with the author, but not engage in that sort of public forum that attracts a lot of trolls. You can highlight your own sections, but you can also see what other people can highlight. And we also see that on the Kindle, right? For those of you that have a Kindle, this is from the iOS app. You know that you can highlight and take annotations, but you can also share those notes with other people, and you can see what other people can highlight. That is what user participation looks like these days. And it's actually going another step further. So that was really still about output. And what I like to say is, you know, good marketers have always researched their audiences. These days, great marketers know that they need to research their users and not just their audience, which looks different and has a very different kind of research techniques. Really great marketers, extraordinary marketers, actually invite their users to help design what they're doing. The idea of participatory design has been around for 30 to 40 years. It's been around in architecture, but it's usually, or industrial design. So far it's been focused on the designing of physical things. But there are a lot of people, and a lot of people using techniques about how to bring people into the design of digital artifacts, like websites or blogs or that sort of thing. And we're starting to do sort of these things, things like using focus groups, ideation groups, card sorting, the simplest version of it is help, having people help you organize your content rather than you constantly trying to take a guess at which organization makes the most sense for them. You basically put a bunch of stuff in front of a user and you say, can you please organize this in a way that makes sense to you? And then you observe how did they group it and why. Affinity mapping, all of these are different techniques, and these are things that we tend to do more and more in our work. So I have one final story to tell you that I think, or hopefully, is going to wrap up all of this. As John said, I am Estonian, at least half Estonian. My father was born there. And there are three things that I would like you to know about Estonia before you go. The first is that it is a natively digital country. It's a weird little country. It's the home of Skype, which almost no one knows, but it's where it was invented and where it is still run. They vote online. They do their taxes online. Internet access is a constitutional right. You have a constitutional right to have access to the internet. No more arguing over the Wi-Fi code. You're legally required to have it. They also are the first country to establish the idea of an e-residency or a digital residency. So you can apply, even if you're sitting in the US, to become a digital resident of Estonia. That's designed to help businesses start up, especially businesses where establishing a physical presence may not even make sense. Right, so they're turning to those businesses and say, okay, we get it. We're gonna help you start up business, become a resident business in Estonia, but we're not gonna make you put a physical office here because it doesn't make sense anymore. The second thing I would like you to know is that the language is super strange. Those are all real words and like real everyday words. For the first one, that just means ice edge. That is really important when you're that far north and winter lasts 6 months a year. The last one is actually how we say Merry Christmas. These are all like words that we use every day, and yes, we know that it's really strange. It has no gender. This is the big joke inside Estonia. They like to joke even amongst themselves. There's no future in Estonia, it's true. There's no future tense. If you're curious, we just say, I do it tomorrow. I do it later. There's no future tense. And the last thing I'd like you to know is that Estonians are nuts about singing, especially choral singing. They're absolutely wild about it. Everybody has to do it. I can testify to this. It's kind of like soccer in the US, where like regardless of talent, all little kids have to learn how to play soccer, which I was also tortured with. But the same thing is with singing. I can't sing worth a damn, and for 8 years I had to go every single Sunday and sing in a choir. It's something that is so integral to their culture that it's really the background for the next thing that I'm going to show you. So what you're looking at is a panoramic view of a festival called the Song Festival, or Laulupidu. It happens every few years. I want to give you a sense of scale. So that stage holds 20,000 to 30,000 performers. That's the choir. The orchestra is like buried in there somewhere. I don't even know where, like they're like right there. That's the whole orchestra. That's the choir. This is the audience going out there. So the choir has anywhere from 25 to 30,000 people in it. There's another 250,000 people on the grounds. To give you a sense of scale, there are only 1 million people in Estonia total. So you're looking at a third of the country that comes together every few years just to sing songs. That's it. If you can imagine what it would take to get a third of the US into one place, 100 million people into one place to do one thing at one time, it'll just give you a sense of what it looks like. So the backstory to this is that they are used to having this festival every few years. But when they were occupied by the Soviets, they kind of sort of weren't allowed to hold this festival. In fact, the way that it really started off is that the Soviet Union was saying, you can have the festival as long as you sing in Russian. They say, but none of us know Russian. And they said, well, then I guess you're not singing those songs. So they didn't have it for a long time. But right in about 1989, which if you're old enough, was the year the Berlin Wall went down, they decided, that's it, we're gonna have the festival again. It's been several years. But we're going to host it, and so 300,000 people arrive outside the capital city, and they start to sing this song. Now, I'm going to assume none of you speak Estonian, so far what they've said is beautiful is the summer and the evening. And we'll go on to the night. This song is interesting because it doesn't really mention Estonia. The title of it is Beautiful Land. And it doesn't really mention Estonia, but as you can see from this video comes from, it's actually 2014, but it's the same song, and they're doing it in commemoration because the song becomes really important. So there's a lot of harmony and melody, but because Estonians have all been through their choir, again, the audience is singing along, and they're not all just singing the same song the way we might sing along to like the national anthem or anything. They're all singing in their four-part harmony. The tenors know what to do, the basses know what to do, the altos and the sopranos know what to do. And during 1989, there's a lot of Soviet and Russian soldiers out on the periphery just kind of keeping step on things. They're just trying to watch things and make sure that everything comes out okay. And as they listen to the song, they're getting more and more nervous. Now, of course, they don't understand the words any more than you do. Right? They don't know what's being sung, but they're watching 300,000 people sing four-part harmony to a complicated song in unison, and they're getting nervous. And they especially get nervous right when it comes up. Sorry, I'm going to back up. Sorry. Right about this point. What they're saying is, beautiful is the land that I know. Shifts, right? Gone are the light voices, in comes this almost martial beat, and the basses are singing, and the men are coming in, and they're coming in, there's a thumping, and then the tenors and the altos begin to join them, and the harmony is actually gone. They're now all singing the exact same notes in unison, and at this point, basically, the Russian soldiers flip out, right? They flip out and they try to shut down the entire festival because they hear unison, they hear strength, they hear courage, and of course what they really hear is rebellion and revolution. That's all that they know that is going on. And to make a very long story short, the Estonians basically say, no, you're not shutting down the song festival. I mean, there's 300,000 of them and maybe 50 Russian soldiers, and they finally said, like, you know, we've had it. We've had enough. You invaded 50 years ago. You erased the government. A bunch of people went into exile. You murdered some people. We can't find toilet paper anymore. I kid you not, that was in the newspaper at the same time because the economy is so terrible. And now you're taking away the singing. We're done. And 3 months later, they had declared independence, and now Estonia is independent and is part of the EU and is part of NATO, and is a completely independent country. Now, what I think is pretty interesting is that, and this is part of the story that I'm going to finish with you, is that when the Soviets started to move to shut down the festival, the initial reaction amongst the Estonians was confusion. They didn't understand why the Russians were upset. Because when they're singing this part, does anybody want to take a guess as to what they're actually singing? Again, I'm going to assume you don't know Estonian, just to cut it short. What they're actually saying is, we will listen to the children and the grandchildren and the great-grandchildren, and then we'll go out into the field. They are singing about kids. Right? And my sole point in bringing that to you is to say that sometimes the meaning isn't in the words at all. Right? Sometimes the meaning that counts, the meaning that causes a change that is effective, is entirely in the orchestration. So thanks, everybody.